Hey, everybody, welcome to Pursuing Pixels. My name... I said that sort of weird. Sorry.
Pursuing
Pixels came
pixels.
Out. I emphasized it weird.
Pursuing Pixels. A proper pot of coffee in a copper coffee pot.
I think I've done that before on this episode. Ugh, yikes. What a nightmare.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to Pursuing Pixels. My name's Kevin Portelli, and I'm here tonight with Randall Nollery.
Hey, everybody.
John Hines.
Hey there.
And DJ Mandolini.
Yo.
And we're talking about some video games, as always. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was left out the other day, but you guys got a nice multiplayer session in the other night. Yeah?
You
guys
were doing
some online gaming. I know, I couldn't make it. Well, not I couldn't make it. I passed out. I started taking this new medication. I've been falling asleep at like 9 every night. But
that's good. Sleep is good.
Yeah, I kind of was bummed when I woke up, although it sounded like you guys had a good time. So even though I missed out, what was it all about?
Well, we started off with some Killer Queen Black, which was great, except we learned that, unfortunately, it seems that the community is
kinda
declining. Yeah,
at least on Switch.
Even more so than before, because we were having a little bit, but it's crossplay, so you're getting people from every platform.
Oh,
although I did see it is coming out on Xbox One soon, early next year.
Yeah.
So hopefully that'll bring in a new batch of people. But
and I think they're putting it immediately on Game Pass too, which should help quite a bit that way.
Oh, that'll be huge.
Yeah,
especially if they have the crossplay ready on that, that'll be huge.
That would be huge for sure.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah,
awesome, awesome.
But yeah, we had a lot of matches that were just against teams of bots, and they'd fill in or populate maybe one round in with actual players.
Right.
But the bots are
still always
pretty
like best
good.
Of three, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. The bots played great. Yeah. The couple times, because that happened a few, like when we talked about it on the podcast before. And again, just briefly, this is like a single screen arcade game with, you know, teams of four against each other, basically joust related.
Go back to our previous episode if you want the deep dive on how that game plays.
Yeah, I think we've talked about it a couple times now, at least. But
after we played Killer Queen Black, then we were running updates for Rocket League as well while we were playing.
Yeah, that new season 2 update.
Yeah, so once that finally finished downloading, we launched into playing a couple rounds of Rocket League and got to play through that new tutorial that they have in the opening screen.
Mandatory.
Yep. It doesn't matter that you've played this game for a decade now. At this
hundreds of hours, yeah.
A decade of time, yes.
Seriously.
Well, yeah, because now they're in that kind of free-to-play model.
Yep.
But thankfully, you can carry over the unlocks you had previously if you did buy it before and did unlock a bunch of parts and things in your garage. So that was nice.
Yeah.
And it is nice, too, that you have to make, an Epic Store account, but you can just, if you're playing on Xbox and then you jump to your Switch, I believe it's going to carry over all your unlocks between platforms.
I can verify that exact scenario. Yes, it does.
Okay, nice. Yeah, because you guys were playing on three different systems, right, when you were playing Rocket League?
I tried. But at that point, I had just connected my Epic account to both places, and it wasn't quite up to date, I think, on their servers. But when I tried right after we were done, I'm like, oh, geez, now it's there. So I do want to try it again because it would work that way, which is awesome.
Yeah, and then DJ and I were playing some more Rocket League. We didn't play too long, but we just played 5 quick games and 5-0, just ripped through it. It was a wonderful, we were playing against some pretty high ranked. Again, I know it was a new season, but we were seeing some nice, some gold tier players, and we were taking them down in a little 2v2-on-2.
Yeah, we were consistently getting teams too, not just randos that got paired together. I think
all 5 matches were us against another team, where it does a little cutscene in the beginning.
Yeah,
ranked,
which feels great when you've got
DJ and I only play ranked, man.
Of course,
come on. Come on. Yeah.
Game
felt game. Great when you see the enemy team is named Good Game Loves. It's like, okay, fuck you. I get too irritated too easily sometimes. Whenever they score and go, what a save, I'm just steamed.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. After game, I just started spamming that immediately after we won. What a save, what a save, what a save. Because I'm just like, fuck you. You scored one goal on us. Shut up.
That was at the end of our gaming session where we got matched against the same team that crushed us the first game, and then we...
And they let us know.
Oh, yeah. No, they were not courteous about anything. And then
you called them rematched
and beat them, like, not like by any, like, we didn't crush them or anything, but man, it just felt so good to still them, like, rage quit right at the end.
Oh, yeah.
Right before they lost.
Yeah. Did they actually forfeit or did they just drop out?
Oh, they forfeit.
Yeah, they
forfeit. Well, I guess what's the difference?
They left. Same difference, yeah.
Yeah, it was unranked, so you're allowed to just dip in those.
You can just jump out, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but no, it feels so good to, like, I never rub it in initially, but I will retaliate. Like, if you're going to rub it into me and we can come back, I'm definitely going to start smearing it right back in your face.
I go the opposite way. My strategy is to rub it in with kindness, and then I make them feel bad, or at least try to make them feel shame. But sometimes that probably doesn't work.
I do sometimes, but so you can just tell some people are so trolly. And I mean, it's not like you're getting on. If somebody's acting like that, it's not like you're going to get under their skin by, like, doing the same thing back to them. It's like so childish.
Right.
But I can't help myself sometimes. So
my favorite is when you would just type in the score of the match.
Oh, yeah. I haven't done that in a while. But after we would win, like, if they kept doing, if people are acting shitty, if we won, like, you know, I'd just type 4-2.
That's pretty good.
It's pretty good. It's like you're not, I guess it is being a dick, but it's like not that bad. You know, I'm not saying anything that rude.
Smash him with
But DJ, I know you've been playing, had some online sessions without us as well. What have you been playing?
I returned to Apex Legends, actually, which I feel like it's been at least a year since I've played that game.
Oh, man.
Yeah, and I've been wanting to, I saw a trailer for, like, the new update the other day, and it looks sweet, like the new setting or whatever, the new area.
Yeah, I at this point, I don't know how, like, much has changed in total or, like, what the most recent changes have been. It's been, like, at least 4 seasons since I've been on, but, like, yeah, it's nice because, like, back when I was playing, there was only one map, but now there's variations, and they've introduced, like, this machine that you can, like, craft some materials with, like, instead of just being subject to whatever you find, which is kind of cool.
Oh, cool.
But, like, most notably different with this is, like, just my personal experience playing with people I know. Our old roommate Steve has been on the multiplayer gaming, so he got a crew together, and it's been good to play this game, like, just with people you know. And,
like, communicating and whatnot.
Yeah, because I wouldn't, like, I've had, like, an earpiece or whatever, but I would never use it with random people. It's just, like, I have no interest in doing this, but, like, with us all,
the chances of getting someone that's actually going to, like, strategize with you are, like, pretty much nothing.
Yeah, and it's also just allowed me to, like, more comfortably test out new people, because I'd always feel like, well, I should just stick to who I think I'm good with because I don't want to piss these people off. But just like, oh, let's try these different things. And yeah, it's been kind of nice to be comfortable going outside my comfort zone. But then, like, also just the wins are just so much more satisfying because you're just feeding off each other's energy. It's real good.
Nice. Yeah. Is it still teams of three? So is it like it's like a battle royale type game with teams of three, or have they changed that at all?
There's teams of three and teams of two. And they also have a ranked mode, but that's only for teams of three. Yeah. I would love to see what a solo mode would look like, just because, I mean, with that game, I mean, it's by Respawn. So people that made Titanfall, and just like that same feeling of, like, agility.
Really dynamic.
Yeah, just like fucking, I can start at the top of the hill, slide for like 100 yards, just like at a fast pace, and just feel so good, and you just carry that momentum. It's a great feeling game, so it's been nice to go back to it. And it does make me want to go back to Titanfall 2, but I would want some company with that.
Does that have crossplay? Because it's on Game Pass now.
That's
a
good question.
Because if it does, we got to sync up on that.
I would love that.
Yeah, because I was enjoying, I just played a tiny bit, because I think you put me on the spot, Deej, on like a episode way back in the day, like, you got to play Titanfall, so I did. We had some kind of thing running where we were challenging each other to play games for like two episodes. But yeah, I played some of that, and I was really into it, so I just never went back to it.
Well, if you ever want to go back, hit me up. I'd be more than happy. Yeah. Game's super fun.
DJ, would you specifically go back for multiplayer in Titanfall 2?
Yeah. Yeah. The story is, it's nothing wrong with it, but nothing worth returning to, in my opinion.
Oh, really? Just, I've heard good things about the campaign. I was kind of looking forward to playing that.
Yeah.
I think I got the vibe, because I played a little bit of the campaign, and I got the vibe that it was like, maybe people were just more excited because I think the first game didn't have a campaign at all.
Right.
And this was like, oh, there's like a solid kind of campaign that like utilizes the mechanics. But it felt like it was going to be a short, like, extended tutorial that was like 5 hours long or something.
Which just sounds amazing to me.
Get to the multi. Yeah, for real. Yeah. That's it, you know, we like our short games. So,
yeah, it does do a great job of introducing you to all the different titans and whatnot.
Yeah.
So, yeah. But yeah, I will try to stop my multiplayer gaming so I can, you know, sync up with you guys on a game or two. Maybe
you're all over that PlayStation Plus lately, and I canceled mine, so I'm out of luck.
Me too.
Syncing up with you there, man.
We'll see.
You canceled too, Randall?
Yeah.
Okay, I don't feel guilty anymore. Yeah. Get it out of here. PS Plus, get out of here.
But Just Cause 4 just came out for free.
That does look cool. Those Just Cause games look pretty cool. At least with 2.
I bought 3 on sale. They have that Black Friday sale, so I'm kind of curious about that guy.
Please play 3, and then let's talk. I fucking love that game.
Well, Deej, too, before we move on, too, I know you've been playing something that John's talked about in the past, too, a little retro action.
Yeah, yeah. Before, I'd been, you know, doing some sandbox stuff, and I'd been complaining about, like, you know, always taking time out to search for these secrets and not feeling like I'm investing my time, like, as well as I'd like. So I've gone to something more straight, like pure game, like no secrets. Yeah. So I've played Mario's Super Picross on the Super Nintendo Online. And this game is, I thought it was going to be like a walk in the park at the beginning, and now it's kind of whooping my ass.
So is this the first Picross
game? I can't wrap my head around Picross. Yeah.
Is this the first Picross game that you played?
I mean, I've done a little demo of like a Pokemon Picross, but yeah, this is my first like true playthrough of a Picross game. And
nice.
I wasn't expecting it to be so big, like, at first, like, you're shown just like, okay, you've got these first four like worlds that have like 12 levels each. And then it's just like, oh, once you beat those, then you unlock another tier of stuff. And it's just like, oh, there's like over 100 total levels in this. Is pretty sweet.
Yeah, and like once it starts adding in like the Wario levels as well, like that was the first time that I was like, oh yeah, this isn't just like there is like kind of a little bit of a Mario mechanic at least in taking place in it.
So I haven't done the Wario stuff actually. Can you talk about that a little bit?
The Wario stuff.
It kind of honestly, like, I haven't played this game in a while, so I don't really remember what the mechanics are specifically for the Wario mode, but I know that it is, like, it's a new set of rules, but not necessarily the, like, without changing the mechanics of a Picross. I think it's either, like, not showing you a hint, or it's not, like, telling you when you've made a mistake, something along those lines.
Oh,
so it is kind of, like, a harder difficulty for the Wario levels.
Yeesh.
Okay, I'm not fucking with that. If I can justify it in my head that I beat the game, then I can move on.
No, but that doesn't sound like you, DJ. Not beating Wario mode. That's not beating the game.
Come on, DJ.
I mean, do what your heart desires.
Well, so if you're not told when you make a mistake, does that mean that the amount of time you see on the clock might not be accurate, that you might actually have less time?
The time goes in reverse. That's the Wario. That's Wario mode.
Oh, what the
fuck? So instead of a countdown, it's a count up.
What?
I think.
But, okay. And
is in Mario mode, is there a timer that goes... It's a countdown,
yeah,
it's so you lose 30, if you 30 don't.
30 minutes. Yeah.
Yes. So, yes, yeah. With Wario, it's I think it's just an unlimited thing where it's like... Oh. You know, like, you'll just see how long it takes for you to solve this.
Okay.
Speed run mode.
So with, like... Yeah, this is my first one, so I don't know. With most Picross games, are you given a time limit typically?
Not typically. And like that, I've forgotten because I've also been playing a lot of Picross Super or Picross S, like 3 right. And Picross S, that entire series for the Switch. So in the Mario mode, like when every time you make a mistake, it'll just chalk some time off. Or whatever, yep. But like it'll also like it won't let you fill in that like space if you like put it or yeah. So in like later Picross games, they kind of introduce different mechanics to like give you other restrictions. So some of them like will just never tell you if you've made a mistake. Other times you can like say, oh no, this will tell you when you made a mistake, and it'll like just chalk that you've made a mistake, and you won't get like a perfect score. So, like, yeah. You kind of, the point is to do it as quickly as possible with, like, no mistakes. And that's kind of how you gauge whether you've beaten it to your own metrics or whatever.
Okay. So, the way I'm playing it, when you start a level, like, they give you the option of whether you want, like, one row and one column revealed. Mm-hmm. And I always say no. Mm-hmm. So... I've been doing that, and if I lose, if I have to go back, I start fresh, as in I still have to justify why each of these, like, why each of these markers are accurate. I can't just, like, memorize where I was and pick up from where I left off. Like, I've replayed a couple levels multiple times, and it has been very... very frustrating. Like I
bust out that rewind feature.
I'm just like surprised that as the grids get bigger, like don't you start with like a 5x5 and then goes like 10x10, then like I'm on the last, what I think is the last world now, the special world, and that's 25x20, so you've got 500 tiles, and it's like,
ooh.
Shouldn't like my allotted time increase as the grid increases? Like, it takes more time to fill it out.
You're faster.
No, it just gets harder.
Whatever.
It's once you've internalized some of the logic where, like, if I'm playing like a 15x15. And, like, I have an 8. I know that the middle one...
Right in the middle, yep.
Right in the middle. That's done. And then you just kind of have to internalize, like, those things. Like, it is kind of a new language or a logic.
Yeah. The 25 by 20 is tricky, too, just because it's they're different. So, like, an 11 on one side... Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean the same thing as 11 on the other.
Right. It's not an equal, like, square grid. Yeah. All right. Do you see yourself going to play like more Picross games, like, or is it just kind of like, oh, this is on the Super Nintendo Switch Online, cool to play, or like I want to play more Picross, or is it just kind of like, eh, cool to play at once?
That's a good question, and I don't know. I feel like regardless, I need a break after this because it gets to the point where like I'm going to bed, but I'm still like playing it in my head, and it's just like,
yeah.
That's always a dangerous sign, but I don't know.
It's the sign of a great game, too, when you're thinking about the puzzles, you know, in your head, you know, solving things when you're going to sleep.
Yeah. I'd be curious to see what other games, how they do it. So I'd be curious. I know John's, you do a lot. So if you ever want to throw any wrecks out there,
I'll let you know.
Well, you at least have that resolution game, John. Mm-hmm. So
We'll do murder by numbers together.
But yeah, I think I'll just jump into what I was going to talk about this week. And I've been, it's been a while, but back with, you know, it's been a while also since I've talked about anything, I think, from the itchio bundle for racial justice and equality, but I'm not sure. But I know the PICO 8, like, platform as a whole, which is like this 8-bit fantasy retro console.
Yeah.
That has, it's like closer to, It's got way more. I don't know how to explain it because it's like lower res than NES, but then at the same time, they just released this game called Poom,
yeah,
which is literally Doom on PICO 8, yeah, and it's like a full blown, like,
runs pretty well too.
It looks amazing. Yeah. Like, it looks like very similar to the original release of Doom on PC. Like, I mean, it's obviously even more pixelated, but it's impressive.
It is.
Like, it's very impressive.
It's really cool.
So people are doing some crazy stuff on there. But, you know, so I was kind of thinking, you know, I played a couple PICO 8 games. I think I even mentioned I played the PICO 8 Celeste, and there's actually a ton of PICO 8, like, Celeste mods that I've tried out. There's a ton of those, like at least like 10 or so, that people just like making new levels essentially, or even like just new take on the concept, but similar take. But yeah, I decided to kind of bounce around. It's cool because, like, it opens up like almost like an old, like, PC platform, like DOS or something. And so you can actually type in, instead of like looking for games on itchio or wherever, you can just type in Splore, like explore, but S-P-L-O-R-E, and it'll open up like a menu where you can actually like favorite games, and you can look at the feed, like it connects to the internet and it loads up like featured games, and you'll load up like 30 or 40 at a time, and then you can keep scrolling down.
That's
load
cool.
More. And it also has like new releases on there too, and you can type in stuff and search and look for, if you find a cool game, you can like load more carts from this creator. I mean, sometimes they don't have more than one thing, but I have found a shit ton of games, and by the time this episode comes out, there'll be at least, I've got at least 24 videos that are going to be on our YouTube channel. So I'll have a PICO 8 playlist. But some of these games are like, they're super bite-sized, and I kind of was initially drawn to it like seeing a lot of these little like bite-sized platformers, and like, oh cool, retro platformers, that's my thing.
Yeah,
like, and I did play quite a few of those, but I wanted to kind of highlight the thing that caught my eye, that made me, the game that caught my eye that made me just really go, I gotta fire up that PICO 8, is this new release came out right around Halloween, I think, called High Stakes. And it's like a card, like a solitaire gambling card game, where you have like a, you have 9 cards on the table, and there's 3 rows and 3 columns of cards, and you have the cards 2 through 9 plus essentially a joker card, but it's a vampire. So that's where the pun comes from, is that it's high stakes. And essentially every time you flip a card, if you flip the vampire card, you lose the round immediately, but if you stab the vampire card with the stake, you are able to win the round. And like, the earlier you stab it, but you have to keep flipping cards, and there's like little tokens that you can unlock. It's kind of like roguelike style. It's really hard to describe, but it's a really cool game, and it's just got such cool mechanics. And like, it took me a little while to figure out what all these different tokens mean, but like, there's a different token where it's like, once you unlock these tokens by either clearing or flipping a whole row or a whole column of cards, and then you'll get a token that are randomly generated, where it's like, okay, you'll put this token on top of an unflipped card, and it'll tell you this card's going to be either a 6 or higher. And then so sometimes, and the vampire card, the joker card, essentially counts as a 10. So like, let's say you've already flipped the 9, and then you place that token somewhere and you see a 9 plus, you know that that card is the vampire. So you're going to be able to stab right away, get a couple, you know, points. But essentially, you're trying to refill your health vial. I think you start out with 2,500 like milliliters of blood. The vampire takes all of it away except for 20.
Jeez.
And then you have to like gamble. You start at like kind of a low stakes table, and then as you move, I've only made it to the third table, but you kind of progress, and there's new tokens and power ups and like buffs on each level or each table. And new, like a new character, there's like, they get tougher and tougher. Like, you only get 1 token to start with instead of 2. It's a really, really cool game. And I've gone back to it probably 3 or 4 times now.
Nice. There's layers to that guy.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. It's like, it's a very cool, like, has that, it's more, a little more luck than I would normally like from like a typical roguelike, but it, you know, it really does have like a gambling feel, because there are times where you're just like, it might be, there's like 2 more cards to flip, and it could be this one or it could be that one. There's no way to know.
It's a card
game. I'm just going to have to guess.
Yeah.
Or you could pass, though, too. You can pass and say, like, okay, I'm going to take a minimal, you know, take my winnings. But if you, you know, if your blood gets drained, you your gamp, you know, basically if you get down to zero or lower, you're dead and you have to start over. But super cool game. And then just a couple other I wanted to mention real quick. There's a couple of games called Marballs and Marballs 2. And if you're familiar with Marble Madness, very similar to that. And Marballs 1 was like, oh, cool, like Marble Madness. And then Marballs 2, unfortunately, there's only like 8 levels or so. But it seems like there's like a create your own level mode.
Nice.
I don't know if you're able to like connect to the internet and check out other people's levels or whatever, or load them in somehow. But it's like really tight controls. Like, oh, it just felt so good. Like the physics they're able to pull off on the PICO-8, like that's where it like is like way a cut above anything I've ever seen on NES on some of these games. Like,
okay,
just unbelievable, like how good it feels to play that game. And it's definitely got some cool, even though it's only 8 levels, like it's there's some shortcuts you can take and like some crazy jumps you can make over gaps, like, you know, getting some marble it up vibes even a little bit, you know, like
going
for those high speed times.
Love those games. I need to check
that out.
I
wanted more bad when that one ended. And it's just like this great style, great music.
Nice.
And then another really cool one, Randall, I was thinking to you the whole time while I was playing this, is called Combo Pool.
Okay.
It is very much Bust a Move.
Okay.
Except you have like a pool table or like this basically just, single screen arcade level. And you're moving like a, you know, an aimer left to right and shooting pool balls. And essentially they start off, I think, as yellow. I forget what color it is. But every time you hit two of the same color balls into each other, they form into one and then move on to the next color.
Okay.
And the more balls you have in play, your health bar goes down. So you have to keep like combining balls to keep your health bar from totally draining and getting these like huge combos going. And I think there's also like a time attack mode too that switches up the mechanics a little bit. Maybe it's like a limited number of shots and try to get the high score or something. I forget, but there's a couple different modes, but just very arcadey single player, you know, high score chasing, which, you know, I love if you've listened to any of our other podcasts. And then just two other real quick ones. There was this game called 8 Legs to Love that I thought was really cool. You're this little spider again, like single screen arcade levels. And there's like 8 levels or so. And you get like, maybe like 30 seconds to a minute to like build a spider web, and you're able, again, with like the physics, like these webs are like dangling around and swinging, and you can attach it to a point and jump over and attach it to, like, you know, you're in a little like farm yard, or and then you're in a little like on top of a desk. There's, I don't know, a few different settings. And then flies will start coming around, and you can either just touch them and you eat them just by touching them.
Ooh.
Or if they touch the web, they get caught in there. They'll disappear over time, but not if they get caught in the web. So like basically you just want to string together the best web you can. And again, you're just going for high scores. There's no like losing or anything.
Do you got to mummify them on the web?
It doesn't. You don't get it. Again, you just like get to, if they touch the web, they just immediately get stuck in it. And then if you can just eat them, but you don't have to like race over to them.
Where,
the ones that are going to like fly like maybe above the web, you want to try to get over there and jump and, you know, just eat them real quick. But there's like different flies that'll come that are worth more points and whatnot. And then the other one I just wanted to mention real quick, and this is another just short kind of like sequence. It was called Just One Boss. And it was like this kind of like theatrical, like you're fighting against this like magician, and you just control this one character on like this kind of like a stage almost, but it's broken up into tiles, and all you're doing is moving up, down, left, or right to like basically collect these like glowing cards that'll appear. And every time you collect one of those cards, it'll do damage to the boss. And then once you deplete its health bar, it'll start a new phase, and it'll just start doing new attacks and adding a new layer to the point where like you eventually have two characters that you're controlling, where the blue character does what you're doing like exactly, and then the green character does the opposite of what you're doing.
Oh,
so
geez.
Like it almost splits the screen in half, because if you get to the middle, they just bump into each other.
Yeah.
Because I think they do the same thing if up and down, like vertically, but if you're going left and right, they do the opposite. So like when you have to start dodging like these coins that the magician starts flipping at you, and like all over the place. Like it gets pretty hectic. And
yeah.
It only took me maybe 10 or 15 minutes or so to beat, but it was really, really cool. Just such a unique, like I was bummed again. Like so many of these, like I'm so pumped when I'm playing them, and then I'm like, oh, it's over. Like kind of like some of these game jam games I've talked about too. But
it's a good sign.
I just really, really recommend firing up, especially if you picked up that itchio bundle. Like fire up the PICO-8, just type in Splore and go to the recommended, or like it's like featured. There's like a little star for the logo, but it's like the featured tab. And I would say like the vast majority of those games have all been great. And then have stumbled upon, again, I've found couple dozen games already with many more like queued up that I want to check out. So
nice.
Really, really digging that. But why don't we go from some fake retro stuff to some real retro stuff, Randall? Or at least some neo retro stuff.
Yeah. some new hybrid retro stuff. So
yeah.
The Analogue NT Mini has been on my radar for a long time. This originally released in 2017, and it's expensive. It's like $450.
Even like on initial release, right? Like not just like resale, sold out deal.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, this thing is popular in the retro enthusiast community. Does not stay in stock for long, even then. But I just couldn't justify the cost at that point, but I kept eyeballing it. And like, oh, it comes in stock. I put it in my cart. I just can't do it. I can't do it. I'm like, it'll still be there. It'll still be there. No, of course it wasn't still there. So then like I'm like, well, you know, I've got my RGB modded, you know, NES top loader. Like I cannot complain about that. It perfectly plays all of my NES cartridges. Like, you know, calm down. You know, you're fine. But then Analogue had to go and announce the Analogue NT Mini Noir, which is the version 2 of this system. So this is an FPGA, which is like basically means it's like a programmed perfect hardware emulation of the NES with additional modern features on top that you can edit in this menu mode.
Like save states and that sort of thing?
Not save states. Okay. More just a significant amount of audio visual output options. And things like turning on one of my favorite options is turning on this option to double the number of sprites per line to reduce the flicker. Because a lot of NES games in particular got pushed kind of beyond what the NES was capable of. You know, think of like Super Dodgeball and things like that. There's a lot of games that have quite a bit of flicker to them, and this reduces that or eliminates it in some cases. Crazy. Which is really cool, kind of like voodoo that this thing can accomplish.
Yeah, I don't even know how that would work, but that's awesome.
Because as far as it's concerned, once you boot a game, it thinks it's an NES. Like, it's been developed that way. It's not emulation in the same way as, like, turning on an emulator on your PC. This is, like, down to the hardware level that they took the time to completely recreate the way an NES functions. And then added features on top of that. Yeah, not cheap. It's $500, but when it came available again in February, I pre-ordered it. I'm like, okay, I'm gonna go for it this time. I'm gonna bite the bullet. And I did, and then it just showed up
A long wait.
It was, but I knew what I was getting into because everybody loved that first version of it so much, and I knew that they're like, this is the last time we're doing it. I'm like, all right, fine.
Oof.
You got me. I'm doing it.
You got me. All you gotta say is last time.
Yep. Oh, limited stuff. Unfortunately, it's always the bane of my existence with that collector itch.
Have you fired it up yet?
Oh yeah, I've fired it up quite a bit just to try out different games. So it's nice. It comes with an 8-bit DOE controller. So kind of like I talked about before, it's a wireless controller. It's got a menu button designated on it, so I don't have to press a button combination to get to the menu to change options on the fly. Love that sort of stuff. Love not having the wires everywhere. But also, it's played everything I've thrown in it just like an NES would, and better, honestly, because it's HDMI. So I can just plug it straight into my setup, and it runs on my, you know, modern 4K TV without issue and without any lag or input lag of any kind that I can perceive, which is fantastic.
Yeah, that's amazing.
So playing games like Shatterhand and things like that, which Shatterhand's getting up there in my favorite NES games just in general. I really like that game.
I've only like dabbled in that one. Just barely touched it.
Real good. But even like homebrew stuff, it because it just thinks it's an NES, it will run homebrew games if they're developed for NES. Like there was this like Jay and Silent Bob Mall Brawl game, and I bought it. I'm not like a big Jay and Silent Bob fan necessarily, but like it's a beat 'em up and it's two players.
It's got that like Scott Pilgrim kind of vibe.
And like, sure, why not? And it's actually a pretty good game.
I've seen that. I didn't know that that was developed like for NES.
It was.
I know it's on like Switch and stuff.
Yeah,
too,
they ported it to Switch, but yeah, it was developed for NES. Like, I have the NES cartridge.
That's really cool.
Released it through Limited Run, which was pretty cool.
Oh, nice. That's pretty cool, yeah.
Yeah, but it's got four controller ports built in on this thing, so you don't need the four score adapter or anything. It's just like it's the high-end retro enthusiast thing that's made for people like me, and I couldn't be happier to own it. I'm very pleased.
Nice.
Perfect output.
Yeah, I was about to say, I got to get me one of those, but it sounds like I missed out. I know. That's probably for the better. I don't need to.
You missed your hour-long opportunity to pre-order it.
Well, why don't you close us out tonight, John?
Sure. So earlier in the, like a couple weeks ago, I started playing my comfort food game, which is Tales of Symphonia. If you've listened to our anniversary podcast, you've heard me gush about how it's one of my favorite games of all time. It's your standard fare, like early 2000s JRPG, and
it's a pretty game though.
It's got like a little bit different of a combat system, your average, and two players co-op. It's got some things going on.
Yeah, and specifically, it's the combat that has always been like the reason why I keep coming back to it, because even though it is a JRPG, like, it has that X limbs combat system where, you know, you're basically fighting a 2D like beat 'em up on like a 3D like circle. So it's a very unique combat system that doesn't really exist outside of the Tales games.
More engaging, I think.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
And you know, you're playing, you got your combos for each character. They all control differently. So if you want to play like in Tales of Symphonia, there's a character that like really does play like a fighter character. Like, it's mostly like fighting with kicks and punches, and you need to string those attacks like combos together. So that is all throughout the series. And it was while I was playing Tales of Symphonia for a bit, I only have my GameCube in my setup, and I don't have a WaveBird controller, so I was, you know, having some back issues, and I wasn't able to comfortably play on, like, using a wired controller, so...
Right.
Yeah, those GameCube controllers are so short, those wires.
Although,
ridiculous.
They re-released a few years back, and they've made 10-foot official Nintendo controllers. They might still be floating out there.
I've got a WaveBird at my house, John, and I'd never use it if you want it.
Yeah,
for real.
Maybe. I might take you up on that. But what I did do was I picked up a game that I bought for Switch when it was as soon as it was ported, but for whatever reason stopped playing it like maybe 10 or 15 hours in, which was Tales of Vesperia, which I believe was either a PlayStation 3 or a 360 game. Maybe it was both.
I think it was both.
It was that era for sure.
Yeah. Right?
But that generation.
Generations of systems ago that but I had somehow missed because I've only ever owned Nintendo systems other than a PlayStation 2. So I was very excited to play another Tales game. But for whatever reason, when I first played it, as soon as it was ported, like, it really left me cold, and I wasn't into it at all. And so, like, I think I've probably played Tales of Symphonia probably twice through since getting Tales of Vesperia.
Oh, jeez.
But, like, honestly, like, having that back issue is like, you know what? I just want to be in a comfortable position and play a Tales game right now. So I pushed through, and let me just say, after 30 hours... that game gets really freaking good. And, like, Tales games also have, like, a sort of new game plus mode that, honestly, I don't know, when I think about, like, roguelikes, that's kind of what I like about them, is that it allows you to carry stuff back, or, like, from previous games over, like, in perpetuity. So, like, my Tales of Symphonia file is literally, like, me carrying over data from 2004, probably.
I love that. Jesus. That's amazing.
That's crazy.
So,
that's
like, so each, cool. each new game plus, like, sometimes I'll be like, you know what? I'm not going to carry over all of my skills this time, so I'll relearn them. But, like, I'm sure as hell not going to, like, forget to carry over all of, like, my, the collector's item booklet or the monster enemies in, like... So, like, there's right. some collection stuff that I still haven't 100%ed because I'm not, you know, seeking out and doing it. But, like, as yeah. I'm playing, like, Tales of Vesperia, like, I'm like, I really can't wait to have, like, my second or third playthrough of this game. And this is a game that I've put 40 or 50 hours into at this point. But, like,
I don't know how you find the time, John.
That's all I do. This is all I do is just replay games that I've beaten a million times.
But, like, there's comfort in that.
It's yeah, just a for sure. fun, like, you know, that's, I wouldn't say it's an amazing game by any stretch, but, like, it's just a unique game that, like, I really, or at least a unique series that I really can't find anything else that really scratches the same itch that it does.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is there anything that Vesperia is doing differently than Symphonia that's like, or is it just like it's gotten to the point where you're like, okay, I'm getting in the groove and I'm digging it now? Or is it doing anything new to separate or to distinguish it?
Honestly, one of the things that like I think was really like the roadblock to me getting into it at the first point was the fact that like it added this whole new mechanic where you had to learn. And again, like all of the words are interchangeable. Like skills in one game is not necessarily what skills are in another.
Right. Oh, wow. Right.
But like there was literal like core mechanics that were in like Symphonia, like just off the bat that you had to learn by equipping weapons for a certain amount of time. And then you learn that skill and then you need to have enough like skill points to dedicate to like have equipping those skills. So like it's really slow at the beginning. Like
yeah.
I was just like unable to like unlock extra attacks. Like it was just like
oh geez.
It was so slow. And I think that was just like going from something that was just like inherent in the game to
right.
Now here's a hurdle that you need to unlock and spend time and like that was just I think too much. But you know, once I was just doing it for the sake of doing it, I was like, eh, I got it.
I will accept your padding game.
Yeah, I love how, like, you're like, after 30 hours, it gets good. We're like Randall when he was talking about Monster Boy and the Cursed Kingdom. Like, 30 hours, just fucking end already.
I'm dying here.
Yeah.
But I'm the same way. I couldn't tell you the last time I played a 30-hour game. I mean, I've put 30 hours into Rocket League or, you know,
easily.
Stuff like that.
Right. Easily.
But, you know.
But they're not, well, like, yeah, well capping over 30, you from, but, you don't learn how to boost, like, 30 hours into Rocket
yeah,
League.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, oh, I just unlocked jumping
yeah
in Rocket League.
Oh god.
Yeah,
but yeah, that's all I've been doing.
Nice. Nice. Well, I think that's all we've all been doing. I think we could pretty much wrap it up this week as far as the games talk goes. Mm-hmm. But yeah, as always, you can find us online at pursuingpixels.com. We're on Instagram, Twitter, just /pursuingpixels. We're on YouTube, Discord. Links are at the bottom of the episode description. We've been on Twitch a lot lately yeah. too. And yeah, otherwise, we'll catch you next week and take care until then.
Bye-bye.
See ya.
Bye. I like the orange juice from the frozen cylinder things. That's kind of my jam.
We always used to get that growing up, like
yeah.
where you shake it up.
Hell yeah.
And like
you
mix
shake it.
It's like concentrate, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mix it up.
You gotta go V8 vegetable juice or
yeah.
V8.
I'll endorse
Bloody
a good
Mary
V8
mix.
Yeah.
Yes. There's the pomegranate. Is that the pomegranate blueberry? That's my V8 of choice.
The Bloody Mary.
Oh, wait. Are you talking about V8 Splash?
No,
I like V8 Splash.
Shit, though.
Yeah, V8 Splash. Oh, yeah. But also, the Bloody Mary mix is also very good.
Oh, yeah.
No, but I can't stand tomato juice.
I don't know if I've had their Bloody Mary mix.
They make a spicy.
I didn't know they made a
that
specific
is literally
one
just
I,
like.
I drink it vodka. Just by itself.
Damn. Okay. I do gross. Like V8, even though I think I have a tomato allergy, but I like can't help myself.
What? I really can't blame you as someone who has consistently eaten dairy and like
yep. yep, same.
Destroyed.
Dairy's too good,
yeah.
man.
Yeah.
Who's gonna stop eating cheese and ice cream?